Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming out tonight. We had a really good emotional CPR workshop, so it's nice to see some people that came back. Thank you. And I'm just going to introduce myself. My name is Ben Fendrick. I am one of the starters of NAMI on Campus, which is a student org at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee. And we are dedicated to mental health awareness, alleviating the stigma behind mental illness, and general, you know, positive mental health, promoting that on campus. So if you're interested in joining our student organization or learning what we're about, we have a poster back there. We are also giving away some raffle items, so if you want to sign up for the raffle, and if you want to donate, give a small donation too, that's, you're welcome to do that. And yeah, so that's about NAMI. And now to introduce our speaker, Daniel Fisher, who's right here to my right. He is the CEO of the National Empowerment Center, and that is an organization that helps other people with the lived experience, kind of their clubhouses and different organizations that they run. He helps empower them to do that, to do the work that they do. And he is someone who's had the lived experience of living with a struggle, that can also be called a mental illness at times. So that's some of his background, and he's going to talk a little bit about recovery and what that means. So without further ado, here is Daniel Fisher.
Thrilled to be here. Earlier today, we went over in some depth emotional CPR. This talk is sort of to give a context, larger context, why we might apply it, what's the changes that we want to see occur in mental health and in society so that people can recover. And I'll start a bit with my own journey because that's really what motivates many of us to do what we do. Recovery, in fact, is really the product of people's own recovery. Just as in AA or in substance abuse, is people's own lived experience that developed AA. But it took longer around mental health to develop a self-help movement. And although our movement bears some similarities to AA, there are differences also. In AA, although there is some discussion of emotional difficulties, there's also sort of a sense that you just become sober, primarily become sober. But then people started to wonder, well, what do you do after you become sober? And how do you stay sober? Or how do you, you know, what was the reason that people use drugs in the first place? And there wasn't a lot of answers to that, other than, you know, the 12 steps are very important. But the very first step of AA was kind of problematic for many of us that have been primarily struggling with mental health issues. To say that you're powerless over your condition, that was sort of what people were already feeling. So many of our centers, much of our movement, is around empowerment, actually. How can you actually gain a sense of power? How can you gain more of a voice in your life? How can you have more influence in decisions that affect you? Self-determination is probably, if you get a group of people together who've been going through mental health issues, self-determination is often at the top of the list. So we needed a more of like an empowerment movement. And that's really what I've been part of for a number of years. I don't know if people have heard of On Our Own, the book called On Our Own. The Judy Chamberlain wrote a book called On Our Own. Anyway, I really recommend it. And if you go to our website, that's powertoyou.org. I don't know whether I have a pointer. Yeah, there we are. It's green. Powertoyou.org is the website for the National Empowerment Center. You can find a lot of materials there about stories of people's recovery. And so, but how does it occur? How do people actually recover? So partly, this title is actually the title of a book that I've just finished and hopefully will publish soon, Heartbeats of Hope. I believe actually what's needed when you're in distress is almost like borrowing someone else's heartbeats. It's like you're missing some heartbeats. And either your heart is, the rhythm isn't there, the flow isn't there, you feel an interruption in the continuity of being here. So what another person can provide is some of those missing heartbeats so that you gain a sense of flow. You gain a sense that you're here and that you matter. And this is my family growing up. And I guess I grew up. it was a very serious family. Very serious. Especially this area of the family over here, which this is my mother, a serious mother, my serious father, he was a doctor, my uncle, my mother's older brother, he was a doctor, here's my older sister, she married a doctor, so you get to the idea, there were a lot of doctors around. Here I am right here, very serious, you know, my brother looks a little bit more relaxed. This is my younger sister, who really had some significant difficulties not long after this picture, in fact. She stopped eating, absolutely had anorexia. And my family, because they were very medical, said it must be a medical problem. Turned out it was trauma, really, is what it was. And so many eating problems really stem back to trauma. And who else is here? My grandmother is here. She's right there. And this is my uncle's family over here. They aren't quite as serious. They lived further south. They lived in Tennessee. People are a little more relaxed there. But so that was 1953. That had a very decided, that's me right there, yeah. 15 years, what a change 15 years can make. I was a hippie, that's pretty clear. And I was a follower of Bob Dylan. Did you hear he got a Nobel Prize in Literature? Yes, Bob Dylan just was awarded a Nobel Prize in Literature. I think he was one of our great philosophers. And in fact, a couple of years before this, while I was still in college, my younger sister, who had gone through some of her own recovery, she said, "You got to listen to this." It was Bob Dylan. "You got to listen to this song, The Ballad of the Thin Man." I don't know if people remember that. "You've been with the professors. They all liked your looks. With famous lawyers, you discuss lepers and crooks. You're very well known. You're very well read. It's well known. But something is happening, and you don't know what it is. Do you, Mr. Jones?" And that was spot on. That's where I was. I was in college. The professors liked my looks. But I had no idea what was going on. And I think a lot of what is described as, at least for me and a lot of people, is described as mental illness, is waking up. It's really a waking up, an awakening. But the awakening sometimes can be blinding. So you need guides. You need guides to help you through the awakening so that it is not so frightening and so it's not so blinding. And far from an illness, I think actually it is an enlightenment to be able to see more of the world. But the world's not ready, a lot of cases. Families aren't ready to have you see things that, you know, other people are not necessarily seeing. You know, so you get frightened. You're like, you're super sensitive and super aware. And you think, oh, I must be paranoid. imagine thinking that, you know, the government and Google and all these organizations might be, you know, keeping information on us. That's paranoid. Is it really? Or, you know, the in my own situation, I started to actually believe that everybody got instructions every morning as to what to do. Instructions were put under their doorstep as to what to do. But I wasn't getting the instructions. Everyone else was. And years later, I look back on it symbolically that I was looking for guidance, that I didn't really know myself well enough to know what to do. So I made it very concrete. Do people see beautiful mind? Yeah. Remember he was looking at numbers and trying to decipher what the numbers meant? Well, he was also trying to get directions. He didn't have an inner sense of who he was, so he was trying to get the answers from outside in numbers. That's called ideas of reference, but really what it is seeking a sense of direction and purpose. If you don't have any direction, you don't have purpose, then you're going to be always looking outside yourself for answers. And that leads to a lot of difficulty. So I went through a lot of therapy. It was really actually very helpful. I was hospitalized on a couple of occasions. I was diagnosed with schizophrenia, which I don't think is a helpful term because it sounds so negative. I just went into other realities, and actually I had a very good therapist. He was a psychiatrist therapist, and he pointed out that each time I went through a psychotic sort of period, I actually came out healthier than before because they were like an attempt to integrate these other experiences. So I discovered, for instance, I had to get out of a laboratory. I had to go into another reality to realize that was not me. I wanted to be around people. Some people can work in a laboratory. I couldn't. I needed to be in human communication. In a laboratory, has anybody here ever worked in a laboratory? You worked in a laboratory. What was it like? Sterile. Sterile. Not much fun. Not very much in the way of interpersonal connecting, right? Anyone else ever worked in a lab? No? Well, you're not missing much. No. It is only certain types of people, I think, that can work in a laboratory, people that are comfortable in sort of isolated situations. Now, I'm not sure whether that's healthy or unhealthy, but increasingly in our society, people are comfortable with isolation are rewarded more than people that need to be around people. It's harder and harder to find jobs and work where you actually are in a team and interacting with other people. You know, a lot of technical, IT, all these sorts of things. You know what I mean, right? Yeah. And that sort of isolation leads to a lot of our problems, I think. You know, if people don't, because how do you find out who you are? And you find it out in a book? What do you think? How do you discover who you are? Experience? Interaction? Looking inward? Can you do that alone, though? It's hard to do it alone. Only so much of that you can do alone. Looking inward is part of it if you're interacting. What is it about interactions that helps you understand who you are? Different point of view. You think you know who you are, but you're just reworking the same self over and over. Anything else about why interacting might help you understand who you are?
To communicate with others who may be suffering the same as you are, mm-hmm. and interacting with doctors like you.
Doctors like you.
Well, I hope that you have an opportunity to interact when you're with a doctor, yeah.
In the situation of a mental illness.
Yeah.
And can define where you're really coming from and not the textbook literature, you know.
Not textbook, yeah. I wish there were more doctors that have been through this experience. That would be helpful. Yeah.
Well, we're social beings. We get, you know.
Here, you want to, we got an extra mic. Where is Ben? Ben, you want to take that extra microphone so when people are talking, they can have a microphone? Go ahead.
We're social beings, and what triggers, you know, we need other people to trigger our own thoughts. So it's like, you know, babies learn to smile by being, having their...
with somebody else.
You know, having their parents and others smile at them. It's, you know, it's always like a call and response. Mm-hmm. So having being interaction helps, you know, helps trigger our own deeper understanding of ourselves.
So we're not complete in and of ourselves, are we? Yeah, he's going to give you a microphone, so I keep my microphone.
I think when you're with someone, it also brings out stuff you never knew about yourself.
Right.
Like when you're with people, sometimes you find out, wait, I'm kind of outspoken a little bit, you know, when you're around people. But when you isolate, you just don't know that because you're just... True. By yourself and you're just sitting in a room, then when you start socializing, it's like, I got these ideas better and stuff. So I think I got better ideas. I got these ideas. And it's like, yeah.
Yeah, he's got a comment.
Now what I wanted to say is just roughly like her things you didn't notice about yourself or like I said, oh, I've been around people that have strong personalities, but I'm this kind of weak person. The guy said, no, you have a strong personality too.
Uh-huh.
I do. You know, when I find these things, I say, oh, really? You know, I don't
that's
know
me?
Them.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
That's how you find out. You find out that way.
Yeah, you can hand it to Ben's going to be the keeper of that microphone. So we find out, why is that, though, that we need to hear other people's point of view to know more about ourselves? Why can't we just work that out ourselves? What? You want to give her the mic? You're the mic guy.
I was just saying how we see ourselves is very one-sided, and it's probably, we don't have much influence on how we see ourselves or it's very inward, you know.
Limited. Mm-hmm. There are limitations to what we can see of ourselves. Well, we only can think of so many things at one time. There is that problem. So what we're thinking about one moment may not be all of who we are. You were going to say something?
Evolving beings.
Evolving.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we are not the same at this moment as we were a moment ago anyway. And we can only think about the way we were a moment ago. Yeah. Also, I think we build through our relationships, we build a new part of ourselves too. Sort of a something not only we didn't know was there, but maybe wasn't there. Yeah. What I had to go through in this period of my life was trying to understand what had happened to make it difficult for me to be close to other people. The most sort of telling of relationships are intimate relationships. How you can be with somebody who's a spouse or a lover or close, very close friend really tells you the most about who you are. And so I got married, it didn't work out, and I was left feeling very lonely, but also wondering, why didn't it work out? And I look back, my wife left, and it was very sad, and I was very upset and very angry. But I now think she did the right thing, because I needed to change. And as long as I was around her, I didn't have to change. Because she was sort of complimenting who I was. And a lot of men end up with this problem of having sort of a spouse or a girlfriend that makes them feel more complete. But that isn't a good way to operate, because it's the woman has to be doing twice the work. Has to be both expressing for themselves and expressing for the guy. You ever see that happen? Women have seen that happen. Guys are probably less aware that it's happening. But I actually said to myself, she will express the emotions for the two of us. Bad deal. But that's not uncommon if you're raised, you know, as a guy. That's what you think is going to happen. So I really just immersed myself into therapy. And what I discovered was something had happened in my past. And I had this dream. And in the dream, I was in a dungeon. And I could see, dreams are very important, by the way. Write them down. If you have dreams, I really suggest writing them down, as they tell you a lot about yourself. So in this dream, I'm actually two people, and you're everybody in the dream, by the way. But I was two researchers. And every once in a while, these two, they were in a dungeon. They wanted to leave, and they go to their boss. And the boss would say, you can't leave because your brain looks like... My daughter, I have a younger daughter who's an artist. Actually, they both say they're artists, both my daughters. But I wanted my daughter, the artist, to draw this drawing. She said, I have to draw it because I know what I want to draw. I didn't know it was going to look like that. But for instance, I didn't know how angry it would look. So my brain looked like an angry dog. And as a result, I couldn't leave the dungeon. And so in the dream, this researcher comes and finds out that these two young men who had been doing research, they had some damage to their brain because they looked through a microscope too long and developed blind spots, but they now were healed and they could leave. So their brain didn't look like that anymore. They could leave. And they go to the boss and they push him aside and say, forget that. That's old information. And they leave the dungeon out into the, outside. And in many ways, I feel like that's what our mental health system has to do. Has to get over this idea that these problems are permanent. Has to get over the idea that they, you know, people have damaged brains. They've never found any evidence, by the way, that what's described as mental illness actually has damage to the person's brain. Did you all know that? You didn't know that. You didn't know that. Have you heard that there is some permanent damage to the person's brain? Yeah? Well, the medication does produce damage, but prior to that, or because of that, they don't have evidence. No. And they say chemical imbalance. You've heard that, right? Or, oh, it's a chemical imbalance. Next time you hear that, could you say to the person, could you tell me what the chemical imbalance is and give me the evidence for it? Because it doesn't exist. There are neurotransmitters that go up and down, up and down, up and down. How many neurotransmitters do you think there are? How many different types of neurotransmitters? 3, 4? There are hundreds. They take pictures. When you close your eyes, they change. You open your eyes, they change again. And 3 years ago, the head of the National Institute of Mental Health announced that the National Institute of Mental Health would not use the DSM-5. Did you hear that? Should have been front page news. And the reason they said they would not use it is that they could not find a biological basis for any diagnostic group. Now, the APA immediately answered and said, you can't throw out the DSM. That's our Bible. What are you talking about? And then the APA went on to go, you know, they didn't mention they get $200 million every year from the sale of the DSM. But they went on to say, okay, so we can't find a biological basis, but it's the best we can do. They admitted. They also admitted they have not found any biological basis. So I believe that we need to get the word out. These are not permanent conditions. People get upset. Sure, maybe their adrenaline goes up when they're upset. You take an exam. You know, you feel a little shaky. Get some sweat on your palms. But is that a permanent condition? No, it's not permanent. You can recover. So this, what do you see behind this this dog? A world map. Okay, so a couple of years later, I was meditating. Anybody here meditate, by the way? You meditate. Do you find it valuable?
Oh, yeah.
What do you find valuable about meditating?
Helps with my anxiety.
It helps me relax, get recharged. I have diagnosed with high anxiety, so when I meditate, I usually, it just clears my head and I get fully recharged. My battery gets recharged and I'm right back to what I do.
What do you do?
I'm a grand member of the Grand Avenue Club and I love helping people out. So great. I'm ready to go the next day back to the club and do what I do. I just need to recharge.
That's great. Well, I do recommend meditating. It's called mindfulness also. And it, I find for myself, it helps me center, helps me get centered. Do I hear voices? Anybody else that has a cell phone, if you could turn the cell phone off, that'd be helpful. I was meditating, and I thought to myself, I remember in that dream, I remember this dog, this angry dog, but I remember that behind him was a map, a world map. And I started thinking about that world map, and I thought, I've seen that, I saw that growing up. In my childhood, I saw that world map. And I thought, where did I see it? It was in the fifth grade history room. Had this world map, yellowing, sort of frayed around the edges. And then I remembered it was my fifth grade teacher that took me and many of the students down into the basement of our school, which was called the dungeon, and sexually abused us in the dungeon. Yeah. And remembering that and going through that memory really helped free me very much. I still had to have, it's almost like I still had to have one more episode of psychosis, though, because after I remembered this, I went back into that other reality, and I had to get myself out of the hospital. And I was very, very fortunate. My psychiatrist was an unusual psychiatrist, so I was hospitalized because I just couldn't go to work again. I was in medical school. I couldn't go to medical school. And I just was, you know, like staring out of the window. And I wish that we'd had a peer-run respite, which hopefully we'll talk a little about. Have you heard of peer-run respites? Yeah? What do you know about them?
It's run by people with lived experience.
Yeah.
It's for people dealing with crisis or feeling like they need to step out of their regular in order to kind of take a breather, kind of get back on an even keel. Mm-hmm. But it's run for and by people with lived experience.
Is it locked or unlocked?
It's unlocked.
It is
non-medical. Mm-hmm. There is no medical staff there. It is run by and for. It is for peer support.
And how safe can people be there?
As safe as people feel when they are with others that are going through the same experiences that they are going through.
The safety is in the relationship, not in the walls, not in the procedures, not in the locked doors.
Yeah.
Yeah, I did a survey, actually. There are about 20 now, and there are three, actually, here in Wisconsin. What towns are they in?
There's one in Madison, Menominee, and in Appleton. And here in Milwaukee, we're beginning to put together...
a peer run respite?
Well, we're beginning to put a task force to start the process of getting
beginning to put together a task force to begin the process.
Well, we, you know, it's...
That's all right. That's the beginning.
Yeah.
That's how it starts.
We're starting. We're starting.
Anybody interested, should they talk to you afterwards?
Well, they can talk to me. I'm part of the group.
She's part of the group. Anybody else interested? Getting a peer run respite going here in Milwaukee? You're interested. You should talk to her. Yeah. Yeah, talk to her. It'd be good actually to do it in affiliation with the clubhouse, probably. Mm-hmm. I mean, the clubhouse could... You want to say something about peer run respite?
She kind of covered it.
She covered it. Oh, come on. There must be more to it.
Yeah.
You've been to them. You've seen them. You've, here.
The peer run respite that's in Appleton is called Iris Place, and I have done some training there for the staff, actually, to help regenerate their enthusiasm and things like that, because caregivers need that too. But it is the most, it's actually, the building itself is an old nunnery. And
convent.
Did I use the
that's all right. I think they use both. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. It's a building where they
where nuns used to live.
Nuns hung out. But it is very, very home-like. The activities they have to do. There's bookcases. There's a living room where you can. You know, you.
It's
can
a home-like
sit.
Environment.
It's very, very home-like, and the people that work there are all certified peer specialists, so there's an instant connection when they come through the door. It is funded through grassroots empowerment, I believe, which is,
And how many people stay there overnight?
I believe they can stay up to a week.
No, but how many at one night, in one night? How many beds they have? Three, four?
No, it's more than that.
More than that.
Uh-huh. I want to say eight.
Oh. You want to say eight?
Yeah.
You want to say eight, too?
Eight.
It's a multiple-room facility.
Uh-huh. Yeah, it's a big building, and they have arts and crafts, and people can come in. There's food in the kitchen, and they can cook, and it's very,
eight.
Very home-like.
Yeah. Yeah, I recommend them. Yes?
I just want to ask a question. Who supports it financially?
That's what she was driving at. Grassroots Empowerment gets their money from the state, I think. I think it's general funds. There's a reluctance to fund them by Medicaid, and the reason for that reluctance is you have to medicalize settings, diagnose and have records. Right now, most of them, and I haven't been to one here, but... Most of them, you don't keep detailed records on people. You do have sometimes joint records. Sometimes people just write down what they feel, how they feel they're doing. And, you know, it's as transparent as possible. Because you're trying to reduce the power difference. You know, instead of walking in and there's, you know, doctor, nurse, social worker, and they all have decisions over you, you walk in and there's people to collaborate with. So the record keeping is more collaborative usually. Any other? Clay's raising his hand. Any other questions or comments about peer run respite? No. They're also, by the way, 1/3 or 1/4 is expensive, and you don't have to go through. Usually, you don't have to go through an emergency room. Sometimes emergency rooms will refer people, but you don't have to go through an emergency room necessarily. I don't know. You do? You don't? No. So, I mean, unless a person seems to have some medical problem.
I'm an advanced practice psych nurse.
Okay.
I have been in this field for, 35 years. And I teach here at UWM. So one thought occurred to me about this, I think, that keeping people out of the hospital is a really good thing anytime that can happen. So I think this is amazing.
Goal.
I mean, hospitals are not good places for people to get well.
It's a discouraging very thing to discouraging. Hear, but yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's true.
I would agree. Yeah.
I have a daughter who suffered from depression, and I actually took time off of work to be home with her because I did not want her to be hospitalized and have that be part of her life mm-hmm. story, her life history.
Well, good for
and
you.
And be told that she was mentally ill and that yeah. she wasn't going to get better and all of those things that I know that happen when people go into the hospital. But I have a question about the legal liabilities, the legal issues around mm-hmm. respite and right. how... You know, how are people protected? You know, the peer specialists, how are they protected in the event that someone would
right.
hurt themselves or someone else?
Well, the first part of the answer is that lawsuits usually are due to a breakdown in trust, almost always a breakdown in trust. And these are built on trust. These centers are built on trust. In terms of people hurting themselves or someone else, extremely rare. That it happens much rarer than in a hospital, and I think that's because of this equality. Because many times instances of violence happen because people feel powerless, they feel cornered, they feel frightened. And I worked in a hospital for 3 years, a state hospital, and there weren't a lot of instances of violence, but there were several, and you could always, almost always, predict when it was going to happen, who it was going to happen to. And it was usually, you know, a kind of withholding, controlling, you know, staff person who was frightened. And the other thing is these are non-clinical. So people, you know, are not considered clinicians and aren't really working in a clinical fashion. So you don't have clinical, you know, relationship. And that's very helpful as well. But really it's the trust, I think, is the major issue. You look at almost every... malpractice in psychiatry is a trust issue. Also, they don't dispense medication. Medication is dispensed outside by a psychiatrist. Because just like with the clubhouse, they want to keep it non-medical. You probably don't have a psychiatrist come and do medication dispensing.
There's no standards, but there's nothing that has to
nothing
be
clinical.
Treated.
Yeah.
No clinical.
So, similar idea. Is that, and healing is primarily non-clinical. I mean, it's this idea that, you know, these problems are medical is really not working out very well. Because, you know, if they were medical, you know, we'll take them to a hospital, you know, do a procedure. But it doesn't work that way.
I was thinking more in terms of the family potentially suing if a family member was in a respite, because they wouldn't necessarily have the same level of trust. So I'm thinking of someone who was acutely suicidal and was not ended up not being safe to be in that setting. And then the family...
You have a comment on that? Yeah. I mean, they also talk to families. They don't just, you know, leave the families at arm's length. But you have a comment about that?
Yeah, there is an intake process that would address that. They screen, and there are certain criteria, and the intake is going to be a joint decision of the staff. And if someone is in that kind of condition, they're going to come to the conclusion that this respite is not the right place, and that maybe a crisis resource center is a better match. So they're looking to meet the person's needs where they are at.
Also, respite allows for an earlier engagement. Because a lot of times, you know, somebody is, you can see they're becoming suicidal. You know, they have thoughts, they leave clues, they're withdrawing, they're self-neglecting. You know, all these things are occurring, but they don't want to be hospitalized, or their family doesn't want to be hospitalized for understandable reasons. Here's an alternative before it gets to that point. So a lot of times you can reach somebody earlier, you know, then they get a different message, as you were saying. You stated it so clearly what happens when somebody goes to a hospital. They're often told, even in today's day, that they may not recover, that they're going to be mentally ill, and they're mentally ill for the rest of their life, have to be under professional care. I mean, there is a whole... litany of very negative prognoses. It is, yeah. Yeah, I had a mother come to see me recently, and her daughter had been hospitalized at a famous teaching hospital in the Boston area. And she, the daughter is 28, and she and her mother were told by the psychiatrist, you will never drive, you will never get married, and you'll never have a job. You have schizophrenia, and it's incurable, which is totally false. Many people recover. So I said to the mother, I said, well, this is not true, and here are some, you know, examples, not only myself, but others. And there's epidemiological studies, long-term studies, just that the people in the hospital only see people a short time. And they only see the people that don't recover. Those people who do recover, get the hell out. Yeah. I mean, like your daughter would not be seen by the hospital, so they, oh my gosh, how is your daughter doing now? How is she doing?
Oh, is she? Oh, she's great. She's great. She's very successful. She lives in the Portland area. She made it through a very stressful veterinary program and a residency following that, and she had ups and downs.
She loves animals, huh?
She loves animals.
Loves animals.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's,
that's wonderful. That's wonderful. Yeah. So she wouldn't show up.
Right.
You know, the hospital would say, oh, well, we never saw her, so she never had a severe problem. But it's these are the people that go on to recover. So I said to this mother, I said, okay, next time you go see the doctor, say, how about recovery? And the doctor point blank said to the mother, there'll be no recovery here. Just like that. There'll be no recovery here. Yeah.
I don't say that.
You don't what?
I don't say that at work.
You don't say that at work.
Where I'm working patients, and I don't say that.
Well, I hope that none of your other staff do. Have you heard what they're saying?
Some of them are learning from me. So.
Some of them are learning from you. That means some haven't learned yet. That means some of them are saying hopeless things still.
It's continuous. Right? It's continuous.
Yeah. It's a struggle. That's that?
I said I've heard it from.
Yeah. This, by the way, is today, more or less today. And this is my wife, and this is my older daughter. She's in Germany doing advocacy for women, and this is my younger daughter, and she's an artist in L.A. This is my brother, my older brother, and his daughter, and his wife, and this is my wife right here. My wife played a very important role in my recovery, too. I met her, she was 24, I was 30, and we actually met at a dance. And I was reflecting at dinner how few dances there are anymore. This was in the 70s. People actually used to have dances. And we met at a dance, but I couldn't really stay with her because I'd come with someone else who didn't want to dance. So we had three dances at the dance. And then a friend of mine organized the dance. So afterwards, all I got was her first name, Tish. And so I said to him, find her on that guest list. I want you to find her. Never could find her, though. He had the guest list. She wasn't on it. So it was February and then March, and I had some disappointments. I actually had another hospitalization, brief, luckily. And May, I got out in April, and then May, I saw her on the sidewalk. I mean, she was walking, not just lying on the sidewalk. She was down on the side. No, she's walking one way, and I was walking the other, and I turned around and said, I know you. And she sort of had some recognition, and I said, yeah, we danced one time. She said, well, I'm looking for an apartment. And I sort of knew of an apartment possibility. I said, I think I know about an apartment. She now says I was probably not telling the truth, but I think I knew of an apartment. She said, well, here's my number. Give me a call even if you don't have an apartment. But I said to her, you know, we got to know each other, and I told her I was very forthright. I'd been diagnosed with schizophrenia, and I asked her later, years later, what were you thinking? What were you thinking? And She said, I never saw you as ill. I never saw you as, you know, having difficulties. So she always saw the strength. She saw me. She always saw me. That's right. This is an alternative to the medical model. You know, the medical model, can anybody state to me the medical model of mental illness? What is the medical model of mental illness? Well, I used to draw it, but people got so, who adhered to it were so angry they didn't like me to draw it. But it's basically a straight line, right? Diagnose and treat. It's a straight line. Yeah, right. You just, there's one straight line from here I am over here out in the world, zoom, mentally ill, and there is not much way of getting out of that position. So this we call a paradigm instead of a model. A friend of mine from Australia, she said, don't use the word model. That sounds like everybody fits in the same groove. You Americans are so oriented towards models and manuals and all these things, programs. Very industrial in our thinking, which was good for a while, but it's not too good now. So over here in green, more or less, is sort of, imagine this is a spiral. And this is a development of yourself. So we're trying, you know, you have baby and they walk, they start to talk, they go to school, they, you know, they talk back to you, hopefully. they pursue the development of their self and their connection to the community. You need really a self to be part of the community, because if you don't have a self, you can't develop the relationships needed for the community. And my younger daughter, a couple of years ago, you probably never should ask this question if you have a child, but I said, you know, as a parent, you kind of wonder, how have you been doing? And what would you say? I didn't say on a scale of 1 to 10, but I just said, what do you think I've done as a parent? And she said, you've given me the best thing you could, and that is you've helped me to pursue being the self I want to be, to build the self I want to build. And I felt, okay, I can quit now. but it's a continuous process. This keeps going on, hopefully building for the rest of your life. But sometimes with trauma and loss, and I would actually say trauma is anything that interferes with your emotional development, with your capacity to express your emotions, to understand your emotions, to understand someone else's emotions. And it can take many, many forms. And that leads to distress. But there's still an opportunity for healing. And that's where, you know, if we reach people earlier, we have peer support, we have some therapy, we have maybe respite. People can have trauma-informed or emotional CPR. They can return to their spiral of development. But sometimes if there's, you know, if a person, this is why it's very important if a person's in school to be able to stay in school. Keep your social role if you can. Yeah.
I missed the elements of emotional development. What are those things?
Emotional development. Well, it's really a development of a sense of self, which is how can you know who you are. It's what we were talking about earlier, to know yourself, to open up to other people, to express your emotions. That's really how you start to learn who you are. It's not just relating to other people. It's especially relating through your emotions, because those really reflect the deeper core of who you are, which is, we don't see it, but hopefully day by day, our inner self is growing. Here's a possible drawing of the loss of self. So this is a self-destroying cycle. And I know I went through part of this, and that actually forced me to confront myself and confront that I wasn't developing. So I felt like a machine. I was very frightened. I felt alienated, powerless, and life felt meaningless. And I actually, at one point, felt I didn't want to go on living. And as people earlier heard, it was a cat that saved my life. He just had come into the house. don't know where he came, how he got in. For a while, I wasn't sure. I was in medical school. I was exhausted every day. I don't know why. I mean, I wanted to become a psychiatrist to change the system, but it was very exhausting to go to medical school, even under the best of conditions. But I was still processing these deeper questions in my life. And the cat, though, came into the house, and I'd throw it out, and it'd come into the house, and I'd throw it out. And this happened several days. And I finally asked somebody, how's the cat get into my house? I was up about 10 feet from the ground level. The cat walked along a very narrow ledge and crawled in behind my screen. So I figured this cat is meant to be with me. But when I was really, really low and really, really not feeling I wanted to go on, the cat, I thought, needed to be fed. So someone or some person or some even some plant needs you. That can make such a difference. You go, oh, I've got to take care of this. But I actually said to myself, yes, I want to live. And I didn't realize I'd been saying no, I didn't want to live. And, you know, this saying no to life precedes suicide, often by months or years. You just don't, and a lot of what's described as mental illness is feeling a loss of saying yes to life, of feeling like I don't really want to go on that much. I don't have, my heart's not in it. And this is an idea about how our self builds. This is a long answer to your question about how does our self build. And you have to say yes. At some point, you have to say yes. You agree with that, right? You had to say yes?
Yeah, and there's something about that, I think, when I, with myself and working with patients, is that the power of hearing yourself say, I want to feel better. I don't want to feel this way. And it does something to you. It's, like you said, you have to say it.
You have
it
to
becomes
say it.
Real then. It becomes...
Yeah. Yeah, you have to say, I don't want to feel this way, I want to feel better. Yeah, yeah. That's, I mean, that's a sort of a turning point. It was like a turning point. And the other elements that were very important were, I don't know which, they aren't necessarily in sequence, but taken together, they all lead to a fuller sense of being alive and being a person. And one is feeling that you're a whole person. You're not a fragment, you're not a partial person, you're not just your mind or you're not just your body, your mind, body, and soul together. And also feeling that you have courage, that you can face the next day, and be able to be intimate, to share who you are, to be honest as possible, and to be able to express yourself. I was very quiet. I was very shy. I didn't express myself well. I was in a group. It was like a self-help group, and I'd been in it for a while. It was just an informal group in a church basement. They can be very, very helpful. But at one point, one of the members came up to me, and this sort of reminded me of something you all were saying about you don't know until somebody says this to you. But it was the opposite of what you heard. He came up to me and said, we really like having you in the group. Your quiet presence is very... very helpful. I was like, quiet presence. Quiet presence, thank you. But I remember thinking, that's how people see me, as sort of a quiet presence. But I had to be more than just a quiet presence. And then find meaning. And then meaning is, I mean, how do you find meaning? For me, working in a lab was not meaningful. I wanted to work with people. Do you all find meaning? How do you find meaning? What do you find meaningful in your life? Yeah.
Having a goal.
Having a goal. Yeah.
No.
Do you have a goal?
Oh, God.
You have a goal.
Yeah, I have a goal.
What's your goal?
I was inspired when I went for a big workshop in D.C. I want to spread the word on mental illness and get more clubhouses out. Starting a mission to not only get more in Wisconsin, but I've talked to other clubhouses around the United States and also talked with Fountain House. I think more clubhouses help more people with more survivors. I say I don't believe in mental illness. We're survivors.
Survivors.
And it helps so many people. And I think nowadays the only people who really know is just, so no offense, I know there's some caseworkers here because I know a few I've seen on tours, but it's just like that's the only place we know the mental health system. Mm. More people need to know more about us. Get that stigma off. And that's like, I feel like that's my goal in life.
Yeah. That's great. That's a great goal. In Massachusetts, actually, there are quite a few clubhouses. I think there may be 30. I don't know. There are a lot.
I know the governor of Maine, he was on the board of their clubhouse before he even became governor. Mm-hmm. He was on there while he was mayor. Uh-huh. And he still takes care of the clubhouse. And he's phoned governors to come visit the clubhouses all over the United States.
Well, it's good to advocate for them. So, it gaining meaning. Often the meaning is around other people, too. It's often the most meaningful is connecting to other people and having friends and a family. I mean, peers are helpful, but friends are even better. That was over here. Now let me show you. So if somebody loses a social role, and you know you have about three main social roles that you can be recognized in when you're an adult. Yeah.
I just have a question. Yeah. Might be totally off topic, but does spirituality or connection to I guess like the universe or anything like that work as far as you
recovery?
Know like finding yourself or developing yourself?
I think these are all spiritual matters. It's just what you call them. I tend not to call them spiritual just because people think that means religion. But to me, any of the ultimate concerns about who we are, why we're here, what's important in life, those are spiritual to me. So I think, you know, our connection, with the larger forces of the universe. There are things we don't understand, I'm sure. I'm not sure about God. Maybe there is a God. Maybe there isn't a God. But there is some collective presence, I think, of life around this earth. And it moves in ways we don't understand. And when we're connected to it, I think we feel a sense of hope and power and energy. When we're not connected to it, we don't. I, in fact, believe that this emotional CPR that I'll talk about after the break a bit more, is really, it not only will help people feel alive more, but I think it will reduce energy usage. We talk a lot about renewable energy and let's get it from the sun, let's get it from, but we don't talk about why do we feel we need so much energy? Why do we have to keep consuming and, you know, having more and more power and all these sort of things? And I think it's because we don't feel fulfilled. We don't feel connected. We don't feel that we have enough energy. I mean, you live in a cold climate, so do I. It's in Boston. It's cold. I don't like the cold coming. But I notice the cold much more on days that I'm feeling down. I've got to bundle up so much more. But if I'm feeling good about myself, I don't really need, you know, the heat doesn't have to be as high. That's a huge difference. And we don't look at that. We don't think, you know, why do we need more possessions or a bigger car? All these things are probably not feeling fulfilled. So that's just a way to bring the two movements together. So we're not like over here is the, you know, environmental movement. And sustainability over here is, you know, the health and mental health. They're all one. So if you get caught over here, you're excluded from society. There's that little dotted line and labeled mentally ill. And it's almost like you only get benefits if you're excluded. You know, I mean, why should you have to, you know, like declare that you're never going to recover in order to get Social Security. You have to say that, you know, you're never going to work in order to get Social Security. How about just people need assistance at times? Finland, they're thinking of everybody having a baseline of financial support. Like, safety net below which people would not fall. And they'd have a place to live, and they'd have health care, and they'd have some money in their pocket. Just every citizen. We could do it. It's just a question of redistributing, you know, our wealth. But meanwhile, since we're not doing that, you have to accept a position of being outside of society in order to get Social Security, and there you're stuck. You know how many people get off of Social Security for psychiatric reasons? 1% ever in their lifetime get off of it. That's because it takes so much damn work and appeals and everything to get on it. But we find there are ways to get out of this. One is through empowerment, and we'll talk a little bit about P's of empowerment, and the other is through trauma-informed care and emotional CPR. These are routes out of this. And that's, when we talk about recovery, we mean recovery really from the label of mental illness so that you can go back to the healing that everyone's doing. So it isn't like everyone's recovering. No, it's your recovery is a recovery from this position in society where you're excluded. Which this woman who's a nurse, you were saying, you didn't want your daughter labeled and excluded. This is what would have happened. She'd have been put right over there in that boat, and then she not only had to, you know, heal from the distress that she was in, but you kept her over here. By staying home with her, you kept her in the cycle of healing instead of going into the cycle, having to go in the cycle of recovery. Any questions about this? This is a little different than the medical approach. A little more hopeful, though, too. It means it could happen to anyone, and it means anyone can recover. It's just a, you know, it's just that's where people end up.
Is there no place in the entire system of recovery for the medical piece?
Well, I'm a psychiatrist. I write scripts. I mean, if you mean by the medical piece, giving medication.
No, that's
no.
Not
what that. Do you mean? Hospitals?
Well, there's a lot of therapy that happens within a
That's not medical. Therapy I don't consider medical. You mean like psychotherapy?
Clinical therapy, treatment.
Yeah, clinical. That's a little different than medical. Medical, I think of hospitals and...
It's helpful to understand what you mean by medical.
Yeah,
yeah. I don't understand that there's no role at all for...
Well, here, the cycle of healing, treatment and treatment can occur there. I should put down here psychotherapy. That can be helpful.
I have a comment. Medical model really means like deficits, right? That's what you're
it's
looking
a deficit, at. Pathological
you're looking,
model.
Yeah, this is somebody who's sick. These are the deficits in the person.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I think of. When you say medical, it's the
well,
way...
I know what you mean when you say medical.
That's what I mean.
Okay.
Yeah, same thing. I mean a system of thinking which says... It's like a medical illness, like diabetes. It's nothing like diabetes, except diabetes is nothing like it's described either. But by diabetes, you know, they say, well, there's something missing, and you give insulin, and you're compensating for, you know, something chemically missing. Medical, chemical, yeah. And in our present day, that's what medical model tends to mean, that there is a missing chemical or there's a biological part that isn't functioning properly. So the psychotherapy, though, can occur in any of these. And I'm in favor of psychotherapy. I think it can be helpful. I think that it needs to be practiced differently, though, in a more egalitarian fashion. And there is an approach in Finland called open dialogue, which is much more egalitarian and is much more successful. And they actually work with the whole family together. You know, for instance, if you were in your situation, they'd say, oh, yeah, good idea. If you can stay home, wonderful. And we'll be here with you. And we'll assist you with your daughter. They do that intensively. They retrained their whole hospital staff to work in the community, to work with family. And nobody's to blame. We're not going to blame you. We're not going to blame your daughter. We won't blame your husband. It's everyone sort of pitches in together to evolve further. And they find that very few people with first break psychosis end up with a diagnosis of schizophrenia. It's a very non-medical approach. They do give a little bit of medication. Only 20% of their
situations, the young person gets any antipsychotic medication, though. Only 20%. They give a little bit of sleep medicine.
Talk about mental illness. I do talk to my students about the similarities to physical illness. Mm-hmm. And as with diabetes, mm-hmm. somebody who's caught very early in the pre-diabetes stage, you can prevent it.
Well, now that's similar, but that's a different type of diabetes analogy than is usually used.
Right, that, but yeah. but it can be. Yeah. So there are ways to prevent. Yeah. And I think of, I don't think that the medical model, I mean, there are some bad things about it if we look at it so prescriptively.
Right.
I think that we need to be looking at a much broader range of treatment or, I don't know what you want to call it, intervention, including things like acupuncture.
Mm-hmm. I'd say facilitated healing of the person's own healer, because nobody ever really cures another person.
No, exactly.
Nobody ever heals another person.
Diet.
But that's...
Diet is another
diet
really
is very
important factor.
Exercise, meditation. Well, that's why when I was talking with Suzette, I was saying, actually, diabetes isn't the way it's described. I just sort of slipped that in. Right. But what I was meaning was just what you were saying, which is, well, we should look at diabetes the way we should be looking holistically at mental health. Then we'd see mind and body are one, really. And our emotions are the key to connecting our mind and our body, because they're the nexus at which the two meet. You know, we have an expression in words, an expression in movement, expression in our, you know, our own body chemistry. They're all affected by our emotions.
Well, in that I see the problem with medicine and purely looking at things from a medical perspective. The problem is that doctors look at this so unidimensionally as opposed to holistically.
One
and
little
so
dimension.
They look at one little piece. The same way with diabetes. You know, you can have a backache, and if you go see a surgeon, you're going to get a very different treatment than if you go see a chiropractor.
Right?
And so the problem isn't that these are medical conditions or that they can be treated medically. The problem is to be so unidimensional about
and
not consider all the full range of treatments that are appropriate and that really can help an individual who might have certain preferences for certain
kinds of treatments.
Yeah,
I'm very in favor of a holistic approach, And this, you can approach it holistically more readily in this healing realm. Once you get over to this, you're labeled mentally ill, it's more unidimensional. Yeah. Well, there's often healing that you need to go through. You mean, can you just skip from here to here? this is more a social involvement. This is regaining a social role, actually. So if you were in school and you had to leave school, like I really, really urge schools to help people stay in school. They help students stay in school. Because if you get, you know, if you get kicked out of school because of psychiatric problems, your life is really interrupted in a significant way. And I think peer support would be very important in school also. So my daughter was, younger daughter was in college, and she had a roommate who couldn't leave her house, couldn't leave the apartment. And just, we did a lot of, train my daughter quickly in emotional CPR approaches, and that she didn't want to see the school counselor because she was afraid she'd get kicked out of school. And that was a legitimate fear. Colleges a lot of times don't want to hear that people have psychiatric problems. There are liability worries. I don't know, there are worries about their record. And so they brought her, you know, her lessons to her, and, you know, she ate in the house, and she made it. She made it through. But as a result, also, she didn't end up over here. She stayed right here and then got back, you know, into life. She just had to get out of school. That's what she had to do. School was making her worse.
I was just going to comment, like, what you were saying about school. I was diagnosed at 7. So they couldn't even describe what I had. Like, I was seeing or whatever. I can barely remember anything. Like, my mind halfway gone. But anyways, I was expelled out of seventh grade. Like, they were doing everything they can to kick me, to send me home. They would say, oh, she hit somebody or something. It went to the point where literally my parents were so sick of trying to take it off of work to come get me. So they just expelled me in seventh grade.
So what'd you do during the day then?
I went to an alternative school for 3 hours, but there was no rules. Like, I could just sit around and do nothing, fall asleep. It was a little office, one level office building. I could walk out, and then I guess you could say, quote, the end of the eighth grade, they were like, oh, let's just put her back in St. Francis. Let's put her back in public school. Put her around there. And it was just worse because at the alternative school I was at, there was only 4 kids. And now I had to go all the way into public school. Basically, I called it a shark tank. Literally, it was a shark tank. And I still had these emotional problems because my dad was at a breaking point where he's like, well, they didn't give her pills that helped her, because he always thought it'd be a magic pill. Doesn't work like that. Sorry. That's not life. Yeah. So, you know, like in schools, they still do the same thing. Yeah. My niece had problems.
Well, sometimes they require the parents to give the medicine to the kids, or the parents can lose their children. And they'll say, you have to give. Our natural drive is to become whole and vitally human beings connected to those around us. I think that's our natural way that we all want to be connected, whole. But when this natural drive to become whole is thwarted by trauma or distress, our distress manifests itself in behavior interpreted as symptoms of mental illness. In actuality, these are but attempts to grow and become more fully human. So what's called a symptom of an illness, I believe, really is a sign of need for change, need for growth. And if it is squelched, it's like taking the smoke detector out of a burning house. You say, oh, I smell smoke. Well, you can either go and find out where is the smoke coming from and put the fire out, or you can say, there's a smoke detector and it's making a loud noise. Let's get rid of it. So that's what a illness approach does. It doesn't go to the source and say what the difficulty is. But there's always hope that people can recover their humanity. When people in distress form heart-to-heart connections with others, they connect with their own heart and they can recover their own humanity. We can only reach the deepest self, another person in distress, when we're able to be deeply in tune and engage in emotional dialogue with our emotional self. So if you're assisting someone, you have to be in touch with who you are, at your deepest self. An emotional dialogue is best engaged in by persons who have their own lived experience of recovery. When you've been there and you've gone through your recovery, you know what you need to provide. So recovery of our humanity best occurs in communities of persons with shared values of love and mutual respect. And we need to create economic, educational, and social structures based on sharing love, mutual respect needed to recover our shared humanity. That's my summary of what we need. Just need new communities. You know, ones where the schools are supportive, where housing is something that provides not just shelter, but a sense of, you know, home-like environment. Okay, you can go on. We'll make this official now. You wanna say this officially?
Yes.
That's a good
showstopper.
All
right, what I was explaining is about a redesign that the county wants to do with the, I said, I'm way back to the institutions of the county. It isn't even the county grounds anymore. But anyway, what they wanted to do is they have focus groups around, and a group came to the Grand Avenue Club to ask how, if we have used county services, what their experience was, good and bad, and they were very honest. And I think we spent an hour and a half upstairs on the fourth floor and talked about those things, and they were all written down and tracked. So, so it's in progress.
So
it's
how would you like to see the services redesigned? This is a good...
Oh, my God.
So, and this will record it, and we'll send it to this this task force.
Well, I was... We spoke to the task force, and we had recommendations.
What do you want now? Yes.
Oh, God.
You're king of the world.
Oh, how do I say it? Okay. It would be more less hierarchical, more egalitarian, easy, more, as they would say today, user-friendly to come in and get help. Simplify, you know, it's easy to understand instructions or what they say. That's the same. More transparency also.
More transparency.
You're in two. Okay, and that's off the top of my head right now, based on what we talked about.
How about recovery? You think recovery is important?
Yes, it is.
Would you like to see the services and supports designed to promote recovery?
Yes, that would be good.
That would be good.
What we had to do if we went to a mental hospital was go there, stay there, and then after we got out, begin to recover, because it was actually an interruption to our recovery to be there.
Well, that's a good thing to tell the task force.
Thank you.
Now let's ask this young woman here. If you're welcome. So we met once before at the redesign meeting. I'm just finding this out. Forgot. But what would you like to see changed?
I think that no matter how much, it's great that they can improve the mental health system in Milwaukee, but no matter how much they improve it, I guess the main problem is recovery isn't communicated at all. So recently we had a meeting at the mental health task force about having peer respites, and I really promote peer services because that's the only solution I can think of where people have more access to a message that you can fully recover, because otherwise you're never going to hear it there.
So you'd like to see peer-run respites. You'd like to see a change in the training, perhaps, of the people providing services so they're more recovery-based, more hope-inspiring?
Yeah, I guess people shouldn't be misled that the medical model is the only thing out there, and everyone should have the chance to be aware that they can get better and there's resources to get better outside of the mental health system.
And maybe those resources should be supported. Those resources should be paid for. Those resources should be reimbursable under Medicaid, under insurance. I agree with you. I mean, I agree with you. It almost seems like this woman here was saying about the hospital, a similar thing about the clinics, unfortunately. The clinical model is based on a clinic, right? And that idea is very archaic, that a professional sitting behind a desk is going to somehow help you to reorganize your life. So that,
is that what you were speaking about?
What, by the way, was the question? You remember the question you asked me back there in Milwaukee? And I wonder if I answered it. You have another shot here now.
It was just the presentation was on open dialogue, and I said, what if someone doesn't feel comfortable, like, talking about what's going on? So.
What if they want to close dialogue? Well, it's a good topic that you bring up, by the way. Open dialogue is something at least dialogue-like, which is, I think, a good direction to think about. I think people often don't want to talk about mental health issues because of the way they're presented. I think you know, like there's this idea that people are in denial and they won't, you know, accept that they have mental illness. I think it shows good sense not to accept the pronouncement that you have an incurable condition. I think if these problems were presented as opportunities instead of failures and chances to develop and grow instead of illnesses, that you wouldn't have the same resistance. The first time I went to see a therapist, I was very fortunate. I remember the woman said, you really need intensive psychoanalysis 5 days a week, which was rather discouraging to hear. But on the other hand, she said, you have great possibilities. You have a lot of opportunities to grow. And she didn't say because you're so sick or because, you know, you have an incurable condition. And so I think if it's presented that way, have you heard this term anosognosia? You heard that?
Yeah,
a few of you have. Okay, so it's a completely fallacious idea, but it's a very dangerous one. So I want to warn you that if you hear it, don't necessarily believe it. Anosognosia is a condition that just a few people after a stroke get, where they are unable to notice one side of their body. It's a stroke of the right side of the brain, that means that you don't notice the left side of your body. Now, that's a condition of a stroke, a neurological condition. And it's actually only temporary, even with the most severe of problems, just temporary, not a permanent condition. Anosognosia with stroke, the neglect part of the stroke.
Well, now that you find it, my husband had it.
He had a stroke?
No, he did not have a stroke. He had a brain tumor.
Oh, it was permanent.
And well, when that deficit took hold, it was permanent.
But even in that situation, what was permanent? The neglect of one side of his body?
He had vision on the left side, but he couldn't identify things. Mm-hmm. He would bump into a wall on the left side, and it was like, I'm trying to move, but I can't. There's something blocking me.
Well, it was a tumor. So there was a tumor in the brain.
Yeah,
tumor is a different situation.
But it was causing this mm-hmm. condition.
Causing neglect.
Yeah.
Okay, well, with a tumor, it is a little different. But with a stroke, it's usually temporary. And what they've tried to do, certain people that have this medical approach, have tried to say that people that have mental illness have an anosognosia of their mental health condition, that they neglect their entire self is neglected, and that that's biologically determined. There's no lesion like that. And the reason it's dangerous is the implication behind that is that certain people will never know that they are psychiatrically ill, and so they constantly have to be treated against their will. It's a justification for continuous forced treatment. Outpatient commitment is based upon it, where people are ordered to, you know, into treatment even when they're in the community. And I'm opposed to that, because that just creates fear and antagonism. Whereas you can establish a trusting relationship, it's so much better. But someone had their hand up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Actually, I know about that term because there was somebody from NAMI conference that like wrote a book on it. And the book was called, I'm not endorsing this by any means, but it was at a NAMI.
Xavier Amadeus.
Yeah. And
Amador.
The book is called I'm Not Sick, I Don't Need Help. And it's basically saying that people he with schizophrenia, that's the specific diagnosis, have this symptom where they don't even know that they have a mental illness. And that's like a symptom within itself. So they'll never know that they're sick. So you have to persuade them that they're sick.
And what you're persuading them of is they have...
That's not my interpretation.
because,
right.
And I don't necessarily see
that term is considered to be a permanent incapacity to know you're sick. No, it's even more serious than that. The claim is that you can never even persuade the person that they're sick. Don't try. Right. You just have to force treatment. That's that. It's a justification of forced treatment. Yeah.
But doesn't he talk about his own opinion too in there, or no?
Like, what's that?
I guess it's more like you have to develop a relationship with the person too. Like,
if you develop a relationship with the person, it's a different matter. But that's not the meaning that's being used under. And that's my experience. There were several times when I was working as medical director of the community mental health center, and the Department of Mental Health would say, you have to put this person under guardianship for medication. That's in Massachusetts, they don't have outpatient commitment, but they have guardianship for medication, meaning that the person, guardian, can order the person to take their medicine. And I don't like that situation either, because again, it's just a fear relationship. So I said to the department, in each case, I said, give me 2 months to establish a trusting relationship. And in every instance, I was able to do that. Myself and some outreach workers, it takes a little bit more time, but the outcome is much more positive in the long run, because the person actually is engaged in a voluntary fashion. I've had people come in under probation, under court order. My gosh, they're just looking at their watch waiting to get out. When's my time up, doc? It's like a prison sentence. So I really don't endorse that. Yes.
Milwaukee just had a film festival, and one of the movies that they had on it was God Knows Where I Am, and I think it was in Rhode Island. It's a documentary about a woman. And I just bring this up because I think it is a really important debate on when do you force treatment. So basically, this woman had schizophrenia. She was going through a very, very severe psychosis, but she was deemed responsible for her own health. And so she had a court order where she was in a hospital, and they essentially could not force her to take her medication, so they let her go. They didn't have the rights to notify any family, and she basically, it's a really good documentary, you should watch it, she basically dies alone in this house from paranoia. And the whole debate in that documentary is, had the sister gained rights to her, and they would have been able to forcibly medicate her during this severe, severe psychotic episode, it probably would have saved her life. So just to sort of bring that situation, which I know is a common situation, where do you stand on that huge debate that we're having? I don't think it's as black and white as, you know, some may seem.
Yeah, so they, unfortunately, Rhode Island doesn't have as many in the way of peer support services as I would like to see. And people with lived experience can uniquely reach people. Now, first of all, as we've heard earlier, professionals are not trained well to reach people who are in a different state of mind or in psychosis. But they could be. And really, that's what this emotional CPR is about, is how to reach people who are in another state of mind. And if we had professionals that had this training, then we wouldn't have to say, oh, it's forced treatment or no treatment. We'd say, oh, you can actually communicate with somebody when they're in another state of mind. And you'd be able to reach so many more people. There might still be a few people that needed involuntary hospitalization, but that shouldn't be the main approach. That should be the fail-safe, the final. We've tried everything else. We've tried peer support. We've tried peer-run respite. We've tried crisis team outreach. We've tried open dialogue. There's so many alternatives that aren't being used and yet are proven to be very effective. Many times people will agree to go to a small home-like setting, a respite, and not agree to go to a hospital. Because as this woman was saying earlier, hospitals are not helpful places if you're, you know, feeling emotionally very distressed, to be penned up with, you know, 20, 30 other people who are in acute distress. And
really not enough time is devoted, and it's not voluntary. It's a locked situation. We need many more, much larger range of voluntary alternatives. And as long as we think that people won't or are incapable of understanding or engaging in relationships, we'll never build these other alternatives. We'll just say more beds, more beds, more beds. And there is this cry out now that we need more beds. We don't need more beds. We need more alternatives, voluntary alternatives in the community. I'm sure of it. And Finland is a very good example of that. They looked at the area of 75,000 people. And they started 30 years ago. And they said, why is our rate of schizophrenia so high? They had one of the highest in the world. They had about 5%. Is there anything we can do early on? So they developed a first psychosis program. But it wasn't really based just on medication. It was based on outreach. They had to retrain their staff, their hospital staff, as to how to work with people in the community. And they send out a team within 24 hours of hearing that somebody has an acute psychotic reaction. They send out a team. Now, you were saying, what if the person, this is thing about open dialogue, what if they don't want? Almost always they agree. Well, it is posed a little bit. You can get the services here, or you'll be sent to a hospital. What do you want? I mean, it's a sort of a choice. But here, we don't have the choice. It's like we can't give you any services until you get so bad that you have to be in a hospital. And then when you're no longer acutely at risk of self or other harm, then you'll have to leave the hospital, and we have no services for you. That's ridiculous. We need to be able to send the services where the person is, meet with them in their home, with the familiarity of people that know their situation. Maybe someone could have met with the sister and her together. That also reduces the problem of confidentiality. Right now, there's this, oh, well, we can't share information. You can share it if you meet conjointly together. Because right in front of the relative, the person in distress hears what you're sharing. But we always think we have to meet separately with the parents or the family instead of together. So there are a lot of alternatives. We've been working desperately to get open dialogue into this country. There's so many resistance to it. I went to the head of the National Institute of Mental Health, and I said, so early psychosis. Oh, and by the way, in Finland, they now have the lowest rate of schizophrenia in the world. Rarely does somebody not fully recover from their acute psychosis. Wow. Good job.
Yes. It's worse than
it's worse
than you describe.
It's worse than I describe.
Well, because a first psychosis that results in some kind of a violent act, they don't go to the hospital.
No, they go to prison.
They go to prison.
We can reach those people much earlier.
Yeah. And,
before that happens.
And what happens in prison? Well, at the Mental Health Task Force meeting yesterday, we had a report on the number of deaths that have occurred in the Milwaukee County Jail that are the result of neglect, of abuse, and they were all people who
had mental health issues.
Had mental health issues. And should not have been in jail because... Right.
Well, they can be diverted if you have the resources. You have to have all these other alternatives, though. Without the alternatives, people end up in jail.
But we've also got, those two girls in Waukesha County who were in that huge psychotic situation, thinking that Slenderman told them to go out and kill a third, and... The girls have been both diagnosed as being, psychotic. They need treatment. And instead, they've been, they were 12 years old at the time that it happened. They've been bound over for trial in adult court. And yet, everyone knows they need treatment.
I have something to kind of a little bounce off that. When I was in D.C., we actually talked to a couple of legislators, and also the governor of Maine. And he said not only with the mentally ill, he's having a problem with that too. Just like we said for the clubhouses. He said more clubhouses he'd like to see to keep the people with mental illnesses in those places where they can feel safe, get skills like we do around, and put the people who deserve to be in jail, not the mentally ill. And that's what I learned, and I think probably, that's what
probably a lot less
on.
People would even deserve to be in jail if we had other resources for them as well in the way of education and jobs. It's a lot of times people get involved with, you know, the court system because they don't have hope, they don't have jobs, they don't have money, they don't have, you know, a place to live. We can, as a society, we need to decide, can we provide for people in need, or are we just saying it, everybody for themselves? I mean, that's the way we are a little bit right now. Over here, you had a...
I was just going to say, I recently had a referral, and the gentleman, his symptoms were very active, and he basically, you know, his illness was his focus, was everything to him, and he remained in a state of, like, suicidal ideation, and that's all he blamed everything for. He hated his life. And I just didn't see even a mustard seed of hope. You know, he didn't have any hope or, you know, anything except his focus on his mental illness. So I just, what
how
do you do with something
been,
like
how long
that?
Had he been in and out of the system?
Basically, I guess since his 20s, maybe.
And how old was he?
My age, maybe 50 or something like that.
So we can assume he'd been in and out of various facilities.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, let me just say this about that. We have to look at young people right away. The sooner that we can reach people in their life, the less likely they're going to have the hopelessness that comes from having been incarcerated, either in mental hospitals or in jail, and finding no way out.
And he knows that he's going to go back to the hospital because that's his life. You know, now that the weather's changing, he's going to have the seasonal affective disorder, and he's, like, planning, or basically knows that's his next step, so.
Well, it's too bad there aren't alternatives for him. Could be, you know, some supervised housing or some...
living in a supervised housing,
yeah,
but he's
he wants to be in the hospital.
Yeah.
Well, that's what he's learned. Yeah, well, he's learned that that's the place to go. It's hard, I think, also, we can build different structures, have different services, but if we don't change the way we look at people and their problems, it doesn't matter what the location is. And that was the biggest failure of community mental health is that it never changed the thinking. It still said these are permanent conditions. It just said we're going to make hospitals out in the community. In fact, in your own state here, the idea of ACT or PAC teams looked good at first, except it was based on an idea that there's a medical problem and they'll actually call it hospital without walls. That's a scary thought, hospital without walls. I mean, if hospitals are not a great place to recover, why make the entire community like a hospital? We should, if anything, be making the hospital like a community. But the idea that these are permanent has to change as well as the location. So we have to change thinking and location together.
He was convinced by the system that he can't.
He'd never get better, of course. Yeah, well, you learn these things, and that's what you hear. Are there other comments on this question of alternative care?
Your story. You mentioned that he had suicidal thoughts, and what is the best advice to give to someone in that situation where, I mean, I can only assume that you're worried that he is going to do suicide, and so to the group, can you speak to that?
Well,
Well, he's so used, you know, that's his always go-to thing.
That's his way to get into the hospital, right?
Right, and he
He knows the ticket to get into the hospital.
Well, he knew enough, like, it was his ideal to take all the knives and hide them, and he's got a case manager, and, you know, I asked, do you have a plan, or are you going to be safe, are you, you know, how do you feel about it, but, you know, he just, you know, that's just his life is that thought, you know, and there's no way, you know, to encourage hope or a way to get better for him. And actually, because I might have been mentioning, you know, gratitude or looking at the good things in his life, he fired me.
He fired you.
Yeah.
Well, you said early on, just 1 second, about this, that he predicts that he's going to go to the hospital.
Oh, yeah, he knows.
He predicts he's going to the hospital. Does he know that if he says he's suicidal, he's more likely to go to the hospital?
Yes. And yes, I mean, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I don't mean it as a manipulative thing, but if a person has learned behavior that they know or they have experienced that the hospital is the only place they're going to get the support, enough support temporarily to relieve some of the loneliness, perhaps, or the isolation, I don't know what it is that happens this time of year, then they're going to say the things they need to do to get into the hospital.
We should be trained as a whole when we hear someone that is suicidal, that we take it very serious and not say, oh, this is the boy that's crying wolf and he's just doing this to get attention or go back to the hospital, because I think that's part of the reason why our suicide rate is so high. And I mean, studies show that people just don't say suicide and not act on it. So I don't want to perpetuate the circle.
I don't want to minimize it, but I just wonder, since she knows him, if he knows what he's doing, or whether it is he's really imminently going to commit suicide.
He lives with the thought of not wanting to live. You know what I mean?
All
his
the
mental
time.
Illness is so consuming to him. It's all he ever talks about.
Yeah.
You know, he says it multiple times when I meet with him. My schizoaffective bipolar depression, you know, this is what happens, you know, I'm going into it. But the suicidal, when he says that, I contact and let his case manager know, and, you know, I noted in my documentation, you know, so, you know, he knows he lives in supportive housing, and there's staff there, you know, that do wellness checks and stuff, so...
Well, it's when you say that he lives with suicidal thoughts all the time, that sounds certainly more serious. And the difficulty is hope has been taken away from this person. That's central. I mean, what keeps people from committing suicide is hope. That is the central aspect. And it is, I'd say it is malpractice to take hope away from people. And when you say to somebody, you're mentally ill and you'll always be mentally ill and you'll never have a full life, you're taking hope away. So the seeds of suicidality often are laid in the description of the problem. Now, the other thing is, I would say the connection also is vital. The connection with people. And when I'm seeing somebody or talking with somebody, they're talking about they're not sure about their future, they're not sure about, you know, their life ahead. I try to find out, can I form an emotional connection with the person? And that's actually one of the reasons why emotional CPR, and I'll just give a quick run through because some of you have seen it, but in the light of suicidality, it's very important. How do you form an emotional connection with somebody then becomes crucial. Because if you say that you have to have an emotional connection with somebody in order to reduce the likelihood of their suicidality, then you need to say, how do I form such an emotional connection?
There was no way to form one with him. He was not open to it at all.
Sometimes people aren't. But somebody might be able to also. If you're not able to, could someone else? Because sometimes certain relationships work and other relationships don't work. So,
I was the third peer support.
Yeah. Well, you don't feel like you have to be the only one. Some of you heard some of this, although you probably didn't even see this slide. we skipped this slide. So I'll look mostly at the slides that I didn't show earlier. So what the origin of emotional CPR was really from what are the essential ingredients in all the different programs we could find that help people through a crisis. There's psychological first aid, there's crisis counseling, there's peer support. So we looked at all these different, and we mostly, the first common ingredient was you have to connect. If you don't connect, you're never going to, you know, help anybody through a difficult time. You're not going to be able to reduce their suicidality. You're not going to be able to help them to heal, to help them to recover. And a lot of the connecting is nonverbal, as we earlier in the day talked about for the people that were here and had an opportunity to see some of the demonstration. It's not what you say, it's how you say it often. And, you know, I mean, if you say, you know, I really care about you very much, then you're kind of looking down and, or yawning. That gives a very different message to I care about you and I really want to be here, you know, together with you. And if you are providing assistance and you can't do that much, you probably should be working in another field. And there's some people in this field that probably shouldn't be working in the field because they don't have the heart for it. Then another important element is empowerment. Can you empower another person? Is there any way you can provide power to another person? You can do that. You can empower another person. How can you empower another person?
Self-respect and integrity for not only themselves but others in their community.
Here you are. Say it out loud.
Give them the empowerment to increase their integrity and their self-respect to redefine and redevelop themselves to go into the community actively, forcefully.
How do you do that?
Through integration of conversation, through interacting with them, not above them, not below them, but let them know there's a level of equality based right here. What you feel, I feel. What you need, I need. What you got, I want.
That's great.
That's how you do that. Yeah. They can be outrageous with their suicidal tendencies, but deep in their subconscious, they don't want to die. Nobody wants to die, but everybody wants to go to heaven, even suicidal people. Suicidal people will talk and tell you, I'm going to kill myself. Let's see, now I've heard this 497 times in 30 days, but we're still talking. I'm okay today, but I'm going to do it tomorrow. Well, before you do it tomorrow, I'm going to come by and sit down and we're going to spit the stuff, you know, and see how you feel later. And if you take the time out to do that, that suicidal person, believe me, they have emotions. They have feelings, they've got compassion, they have an intellect, and they can use it if someone just gives them a push. Just give them a push. Be transparent with them as you want people to be transparent with you. Simple as that.
That's not simple, though, Jeffrey. What you have just summarized is terrific, but I also would contend you're not in yourself empowering them, you're creating a relationship and a conversation that allows them to experience their power and self-respect. You like that? You like that?
Good. Yeah. Well, I was just reframing what you said, because I love the way you said, and I'll come back again tomorrow, and we'll have another conversation. By saying that, you're saying your existence matters to me, and I regard you as an important human being, and we're going to continue this conversation together. That's very egalitarian, very equal. And when you can engage in that style of relationship, then you draw out the power and the capacity in the other person. You don't put it in them, because it has to be in them, and it is in each person. But the way you are with them and the way you described it, which is very beautiful, is from your heart. Sounds like you're speaking from your heart. No, and the school books don't have it. They should, but they don't have it. It's from lived experience, your own life experience. It's probably what you wanted. It's probably what was most helpful for you. You'll tell me.
I'll tell the group about it. I've already told them the two demonstrations you did this morning. Mm-hmm. And the group, they were shocking.
And what?
They were very shocking.
Shocking?
Yeah. The two of you woke me up again this morning. You know, I had stopped thinking about things.
What do we wake you up to?
Some more reality.
To some reality?
What some more reality.
More reality. We enhanced your reality. We
you enhanced
it.
You enhanced it. Gave me more motivation for advancing it. Uh-huh. And now, you know, at my senior age, I'm thinking about going back to school and getting my master's.
All right.
In both social work and psychology. And if I live long enough, I'll take my MBA and go right along with it. Open up my own practice.
I'll tell you, if you have the spirit and you have the passion, you'll be able to do it. I'm almost 73, and I feel younger than when I was 23.
I'm 70, and I feel 19 all over.
You know what it feels
like.
That's
what I do.
Yeah. So today we helped expand your reality some. Huh? What was it that helped you to see more?
The role playing that the two of you did this morning.
Yeah.
And I heard about the trauma situations. It made me go back into my traumas, which I told you. Yeah. I'll think about it, you know, because yeah. I've come a long, long way. I've come a long way from being told that I would never be functionally good. I would never get an education because I didn't have the ability to learn.
Mm. Mm. That's
I would be a deadbeat to society, in and out of mental institutions. And two trips to the mental health complex deviated and changed all of that. No, I am not going to be in this revolving door circle. If any employees from the mental health in here, I don't mean to hurt your feelings, but I wouldn't send my sick dog there. My opinion. How others look at it, that's them. Whether they work there, patient there, or what. Those are their opinions. I think I've had the best mental health service that a person could want to give. I'm a veteran of Vietnam. I've seen a lot of trauma. I've done a lot. I did a lot of killing. I did a lot of murderous things. I watched people and friends of mine die, get butchered, unnecessary. And we kids, 19 years old. 19 years old. And then we got to face the trauma coming back home because we baby killers. And we are. Dog, devil dogs, and you know all this. I didn't ask to go to Vietnam. I didn't even know there was a Vietnam. It was non-existent to me till I got in country. And not one time did I go. Uncle Sam sent me back a second time. I was supposed to be an advisor when I went back because I already had 15 months experience up under my belt. But it didn't happen that way.
Jeffrey, I would love to hear more, and I really appreciate it. But you have already shared so much, so valuable.
And I thank you for that very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. And it especially, you've especially illustrated what we're trying to accomplish here with emotional CPR, is by your humanity, your realness, your being authentic, yourself. There's nothing more valuable for someone else than that. Because when you're feeling at loss, and you're feeling desperate, feeling like life is slipping away, there's no pill, there's no structure, there's no program that comes close to a human heart. It's a human heart is what we need to cultivate, is people being able to share at that level. And when that occurs, when that happens, people do wake up, because that's what people respond to, is another person's humanity. They just aren't ready to come out if the world looks threatening. You stay inside, which gets back to forced treatment. That's why we want to find alternatives like Jeffrey and this Grand Avenue Club. I mean, settings where people feel accepted, settings where people feel they can experience their own power. Because when people do that, what happens? They feel new life. They revitalize. New life, creativity, hope, and interest in people. That's what we're trying to achieve. It's for people to reengage in life. But they can't do that if they're just feeling threatened. They're feeling frightened. Because fear drives you inside yourself. Fight, flight, or freeze. And you can't learn new things. You can't make new relationships. And we can do it. But we have to change how we are. And we have to listen to the Jeffreys of the world instead of the books that are written by people that have no friggin' idea. They're up there in ivory towers. They've never experienced it firsthand. They don't know what it means to lose their voice. They don't know what it means to wonder about life. They just haven't experienced that. And until the mental health system at every level listens to Jeffrey and others of us that have been through these experiences, we're going to be blind. We're running blind right now by remote control. So some people saw this. Bear with me a little. I look at it quite often still, even though I drew it. It looks so simple. This is what we're trying to achieve, is heart-to-heart connection. And also where people actually hear their heart. And their heart hears them. So you're connected within yourself to your heart, and your hearts are connected. In fact, you can't really connect heart to heart if you don't hear your own heart. It's very hard to communicate what you're hearing. But when you're able to do that and be in conversation, but the conversation is informed by what you see and by the tone of a person's voice and the posture that they're giving you, and maybe a tear that comes down their cheek, then you connect. And then life seems worth living. And then you don't feel suicidal, because there's someone else in the world that you feel connected to. And suicide begins when you feel disconnected, and it starts to end when you feel connected at an emotional level. Because this person is going to start feeling suicidal. They're not happy. They're not feeling that they exist. You see the dotted line? I didn't even think I was doing the dotted line, but what do you make of that? The fact that this person over here has a dotted line. What? Disconnected. Disconnected and not feeling like you exist. If you aren't connected to other people, your very existence feels like it's not there. You're not there. Somebody came up to me in the afternoon and said, "This is like existentialism." Well, it is in a way. The importance of being is very important. And through connecting and empowering, you can start to experience
being a whole person once again. And this is just a blown-up version of the two people, except, and I hadn't really thought about this at the time, people's hearts, I think, can actually grow. Their emotional hearts can grow. And they both grow. It's the peer principle. Why do peers get something? Because you engage in a relationship that is fulfilling to both of you. Both of your hearts can grow. You don't have to be in love to have that happen. Love is one example of it. Anybody that's been in love knows you feel a certain pitter-patter in your heart when you're around somebody. But it can happen with friends. It can happen with people you really care about. It can happen in many different dimensions. And this is, by the way, a group together. What happens when you're in a group of people that are able to share with these principles of emotional CPR? We call it We CPR, which actually Sam Ahrens was the first person to talk about We CPR. We CPR means that we're all trying to achieve emotional CPR principles of connecting and empowering and revitalizing together. We're all trying to do it together. And equality, just as Jeffrey had said, equality is very, very important. When you're in an equal relationship, you start to experience your own power. A neutral place, non-judgmental. Try not to judge each other. Listen. And here's a very, very difficult one. Suspend your own beliefs. Don't get rid of them. But if somebody is saying, you know, they see the world one way, listen to them. You know, I mean, this woman here has said that she sees that there's a need for, you know, outpatient commitment or for forced treatment at times. I'm listening, and I'm thinking to myself, I don't necessarily agree, but I'm listening. I want to hear out what her perspective is, and the, you know, what do you do about this, the woman or the man who isn't able to, you know, get care? You know, and maybe in today's world, because we don't have the alternatives, we need to maybe, you know, have a hospitalization. But let's not always do that. Let's think ahead. We have today, but we also have tomorrow. If we can dream about tomorrow and respect differences. This one, by the way, there's a friend of mine that drew this. And she has this guy-looking figure here, and they all have hearts, you may notice. He's saying, I believe X, X, Y, Y, X, X. That's a guy, right? Over here is the woman. I believe O, O, X, X, O, O. What's the difference there? It's Mars and Venus, maybe? He's thinking equations and, you know, mathematics, science. She's thinking hugs and kisses. We do have sort of two worlds. We could bring those two worlds together. I think we reduce the feelings of suicide. I mean, not everybody can have somebody to love, but just even finding more sensitivity to other people. And it all adds up, hopefully, to heart to heart. We call these recovery dialogues. And I've been using them in community mental health centers to try to shift the culture to recovery. So we have everybody sit down in a circle, and some are providers, some are administrators, some are peers, some are people just in their own recovery. And we say, let's just pick a topic and go over these principles, and that's it. Everybody's equal, hat at the door, let's just talk. And it gives a great opportunity. It's not a therapy group, because there is no one person who's, you know, like the therapist. It's just a facilitated group. It's very helpful. I've tried to do some of that right here, just to give you an example of it. And these intentions I went over earlier, I'll just say that we've tried to demonstrate them here. And this was a summary. I would bring your attention, especially to number 3, try to be with people. Don't fix them, don't judge them, don't advise them, don't have an agenda. You know how hard that is? It's very difficult. But if you can achieve it, yeah, 3 and 4. 4 is a very important one, too. And I'll give you an example, number 4. I'm not sure what's best for you, but together we'll uncover your power. Don't enter as an expert. The person going through their own, you know, suffering, they're the expert. You're there as an advisor, maybe as a coach, as a helpful person, but not a helper. And you like that number 4, huh? I'll give you a quick example. So I was in Scotland, and this emotional CPR now is, you know, it's around the world. Poland, Scotland, Iceland, Japan, Taiwan, a lot of countries, and about 10 different states here in this country. So I was doing one with a nurse, and those of you that have nursing background might find this interesting. So the nurse is in distress. Actually, one of the sources of her distress is she can't stop fixing. That's so she's doing a role play and sharing how problematic it is. She's been trained to fix. She's been trained, and she's like, I gotta stop trying to fix. And she's like, grabs a pillow, and she's, And the woman that's helping her has some professional background. And so she says to the woman who's helping her, and there's nothing you can do to help me. And the woman who's helping just throws up her hands and looks at me and says, well, what am I going to do? And I said, what are you feeling? She said, I feel helpless. I said, why don't you share that? Really? I could share that? I feel helpless? I'm supposed to know what to do. I said, just try it. So she says to the nurse in distress, I don't know what to do. I feel helpless. And the nurse goes, oh, I'm so sorry to hear that. Just snapped right out of it. And it's remarkable that even in a role play, you can have very real situations happen just like that. And she was like, and the other woman who was like assisting her is like, really? You're not in distress anymore? She said, well, no, because, you know, it looks like I need to assist you a little bit. So if you say, you know, you're feeling, and not just say it, but are feeling a little helpless, maybe you're with somebody and they're feeling suicidal, I don't know what to do. A lot of times they'll go, oh, I'm sorry. What can we do together here? How can we work this out? It's just a subtle but very profound shift from I know the answer and you don't, I'm together and you aren't, I'm well and you're sick, to I'm not quite sure what to do, but I'm with you. I'm sticking with you. I'm not quite sure what to do, but you know a lot about it too. It's amazing how it brings it out. Does that make sense to you? It's hard to do. And your supervisors might say, what the F? You don't know what to do. And it's not, you can't do it like a trick. It has to be sincere and genuine at the moment. I don't know what to do. And sometimes you just look at your hands. What are your hands doing? And if your hands, you find your hands, your arms going like that, you go, oh, I must not know what to do. Your body will tell you ahead of time. Before, so this is just suggestions of things we might try to bring. One is open dialogue. I can't go into it as deeply as I'd like to. I have mentioned it. Another one is finding our voice. It's a training that we've developed at the Empowerment Center. And let's see if I could show you just a quick little thing. 12 P's of empowerment. How do we encourage people to experience their power? And this is training for advocates so that people can go before legislators, they can go before, you know, Congress, they can go before departments of mental health. It always starts with personal peer support. You need other people. And this doesn't mean you have to be a peer in the sense of you've been through exactly the same experience, but just people getting together. You know, Margaret Mead said, all it takes is a small number of passionate people getting together to make a change in the world, and that's the only way the world has ever changed. So you get together, you support each other, go over the principles of recovery, the importance of hope, the importance of self-determination, the importance of holistic health. You know them probably by heart. We've gotten them from umpteen research studies. They always come out with the same set of factors. But what are we going to do about it? It's not enough to know them. And you say, huh, maybe there's a positive future. Now, this is the most critical part right here. You can't go into a departmental health or a congressional hearing, or you know, God knows you're lucky if you get invited to one, but you can't go in pounding the table. Might be angry. It's understandable you're angry. You've been angry. You've been telling me about your anger all day. It shows, and that's good. That's where it starts. But you can't just live in it, or you get burned out and you feel, you know, frustrated. Take that anger and turn it to passion. You can do it. Gandhi said he takes his anger, like he's still here with us. He takes his anger, he compresses it, and it becomes a source of his energy. You can do it. But you need other people. You can't make that conversion alone. You need other people with you so that they can say, yes, I believe that we can do it together. Can't make it alone. Then you find purpose and meaning, and then start thinking about planning. We do the planning too early almost every time. We do it in individual cases. I think RAP is a great thing. I love Mary Ellen Copeland. You can't do RAP before you've done these earlier steps, though. If you don't feel you have a future, you don't feel your passion for the future, and you're consumed by anger, you'll never make a plan. Your case, the situation of the person who, you know, doesn't feel he has going to live very long, he can't make plans. His only plan is he's got to go to a hospital. He's probably consumed in anger. I'll bet he's got a lot of anger. Yeah, I'll bet he does. Well, connection is one of the best antidotes to anger. Connection. But if he can find a way to connect, and other people can find a way to connect with him, his anger will still start to go down, and his interest in life will start to go up. I was doing a training in a state hospital in Texas. So a nursing supervisor comes up to me and says, oh, yeah, this is fine for people that are sad or depressed. How about somebody that's really angry? What are you going to do about them? So I said, you come up right here. You be the angry person. You want to be the angry person? No? You want to be the angry person? Come on up, be angry. You have a lot of things you're angry about. You were telling me earlier.
Around health care.
Yeah. Anything you're angry about.
Broken system. I'm very angry.
You don't sound that angry. Come on. You're angry.
Yes, I am.
How angry are you?
Very.
Yeah. Okay. Well, you better stop being so angry. Because if you don't, we're going to have to give you medication. And we're going to put you in the quiet room. And we're going to have to keep you a long time there until you stop being angry. Put you in restraints. How do you feel? How do you feel about that?
That is not going to make me less angry.
You're not feeling less angry? Now that we've told you? Now we've told you that you better act properly or you're going to be in restraints? That didn't make you less angry? Really? Okay.
Did it make you more angry?
It make you more angry. It would.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's put yourself in that frame of mind. Yes. Yeah, okay, well, that's...
And also because I think we're told not to show anger or...
Yeah, you shouldn't be showing. You're getting a little angry there. Yeah.
And you're not a team player.
Okay, yeah, so you know. Yeah. Okay, now wait a minute. No, we're going to do it again. We're going to play it again. Okay, so that's typical, right?
I mean, this is not an exaggeration. I've worked in a hospital. I've seen it occur. Okay. So give me some of your anger again. Come on.
I am very angry about what is going on in healthcare right now, and I want to get involved in something to change it.
I can feel your anger. I hope you won't hit me. But I'm sticking with you. I'm staying right here. Because that you got some legitimate reasons there to be angry. And I can feel how angry you are. I feel some of that sometimes too. But you're not alone. We can face it together. It would be against your will, undoubtedly.
Yes.
We can do. We can face it together. I'm not afraid of your anger either. Not afraid of it. It's familiar. But it need not consume both of us, because we can do something together. Together. Yeah. Thank you. Was it different?
Well, actually, this whole second part really helped. Because mm-hmm. that process, I mean, mm-hmm. I need to get the anger into passion. And then all those bottom ones.
All those bottom ones.
Yeah, I want to go right to you want to go the to White the, House.
You want to go to the White House. When you've been through these experiences, you're not afraid to be with someone they're angry. I mean, you just can, as long as you can be there and be there with them, and they don't feel alone in their anger and their frustration, something magical happens. You start to smile. And I don't know, I can't explain it. I can just tell you that that happens. And I first discovered it with this very angry, you were mild. This guy, he came up to me, "So what are you going to do?" I know, yeah. Ooh. "What are you going to do? What are you going to do?" And he was like this far away. I said, "Don't hit me. Don't hit me. But I'm here. I'm here. I'm sticking with you. I'm going to stick with you. I know you're angry, but I'm going to be right here." And I just was right there, and son of a gun, the guy said, "I don't really feel angry." And I mean, with kids, you may see this with, you know, your own children. I mean, sometimes my daughter would be like, "And I'm like, I'm here. I'm with you." Because I think behind anger is often fear and loneliness and hurt. But if you can be there with the person and helplessness, you're there with them, you're listening to them, you're regarding them as another human being. Their presence, their existence matters to you. I think, you know, non-verbally, that's, you looked at me, I looked at you. So this, ultimately, the P's that we want to be able to hopefully get to, politics being one of them, but also presence, that you can have a presence, that you can present, you'll be persistent and persuade people. The slaves in Rome were not allowed to learn literature, rhetoric, debate. These were the liberal arts. They were for the free people, not for the slaves. That's what liberal arts are, is for free people. They were only taught the technical skills. The slaves were only taught the technical skills. Our education is doing a similar thing. Mm-hmm. It's dividing people up and saying, "Oh, you're not smart enough. You're not going to get a liberal arts education. You're just going to get a technical education." Everyone should get literature. Everyone should get, you know, speaking and presenting. Everyone should be able to present and be able to present themselves. And that's the liberal arts. So it's
our education system is the start of all of our problems, many of them. Don't be talking philosophy.
Don't leave out the last.
Philosophy, very important. You're right, philosophy. So any further final questions, comments, statements? You like the peas, huh? You like the peas. It helps. Huh?
Put some language on my emotions.
And your emotions, yeah. Yeah, they should go, the peas should go with the empowerment, yeah. Yeah. Yes?
I was looking up how you were talking about those, the peas. I know exactly, like, the anger you're kind of, like, when we go and talk in front of the city of Milwaukee or something, and it's like, you're telling them your story, you're telling them how good now your life is, kind of, and how mental or whatever, and they're, you know, some of them are not listening, you're just one big, hello? Over there on the left, I'm talking, and it's just like, you got that anger, so it's like.
You gotta tap into enough of it so they pay
attention. That's what I'm like, I just get so angry, so I like raise my voice louder. So it's, I also get that problem too. We have what's the CIT officers, the crisis intervention officers that come. And I know it's a lot of them. I'll have like 40 on a tour. Me and Jeffrey are like the tag teams, but you know, you got some that are like, yeah, whatever. This is just for, I'm like, okay, excuse me, you are in my house with my family here, who have done so much work getting out of the house, out of their isolation, staying out of the hospitals, and coming here, and you're going to sit in my house and disrespect them by sitting there looking at your phone or just looking around like a, like my 18-year-old niece who's, like, not listening to me? I don't think so, but it's, like, in your head you want to say, like, shake them, but it's, like, I just start getting it.
It's a very delicate thing, how you shake somebody without shaking them up.
I don't.
No, but seriously, there is, and the way I gauge that is, again, by watching the person. So I'm giving a presentation, and somebody's like, yeah. Say, this is for you. This is not something theoretical. It's from my life to your life, just like you were saying. And I want you to pay attention to this, because this is my life speaking a language that I hope you can hear. And you look at them, and they go, ooh, wake up. But then if you notice they go, start to recoil, you're, okay, we'll tone it down a little bit. We'll keep it down. And sometimes you need someone else. Don't go alone to these meetings. Go with a buddy. Because I was on the White House Commission for Mental Health. And I was the only person, you know, labeled with a mental health issue. And it was scary at times. Thank heavens I had a MD and, you know, was a psychiatrist, because there were psychiatrists all to the left of me, psychiatrists to the right of me. Through the valley of death, I had to go. And they would say, oh, recovery isn't possible. Only remission. No recovery is possible. And I'd say, what am I, chopped liver? Look at me. I went through it, and they're like, oh, well, you must be an exception. I said, I'll bring in hundreds of other people. And we did that, yeah. And we got into that commission report that the goal should be recovery. Got that into the commission report, and it was just persistence, and passion. But I had a buddy, a woman, she was a judge. She still is a judge. Her name's Ginger Wren. And we didn't get along at first because she wanted mental health courts. I don't like mental health courts. I don't want to be separated out as, you know, only seen in mental health court. Anyway, but we got over that difference, and she was for human rights for people labeled with mental illness. She was very supportive of that. So I'd be like arguing with this psychiatrist. You know, he said, I don't want these angry people come in and training my staff. They're too angry to train my staff. And I'd look over at her and I'd go, can you talk to them? Because sometimes you get caught just on a one-on-one. You're like, ah. So she'd go, Henry, he's saying something you need to listen to. So you need a team. You need teamwork. Well, we're reaching the end, and thank you all very much. Yeah.